Hello, everyone out there. My name's Madeline Sunquist. I'm an outreach assistant with the Brooklyn Public Library's Justice Initiatives Department. And this is another installment of our Know Your Rights series. And we've done programming on housing rights, immigration, and now today we're talking about, among other topics, and today we're talking about trans healthcare in particular. This is a discussion about many different facets of navigating the healthcare system while trans, from transitional healthcare to mental health services. We're just gonna talk to our wonderful guests about accessing gender-affirming health services today. And I will introduce them shortly, but also wanted to make a note that at the end of this, of our talk, we'll have hopefully 20-30 minutes for audience Q&A. So on the YouTube chat, you can just pop in any questions that come to mind as you're watching, and we'll address them later. Today we're joined by Viviana Gonzalez, who is a Chicanx community activist, cultural humility trainer, and transgender non-binary integrated health navigator and surgery doula at Callen-Lorde Community Health Clinic. Noah E. Lewis is the director of the Trans Health Project at the Transgender Legal Defense and Education Fund, and he was previously a staff attorney there for 6 years. He focuses on eliminating barriers to insurance coverage for trans-related healthcare. And we're also joined by Jeremy Wernick. He's a clinical assistant professor at the Child Study Center of Hassenfield Children's Hospital at NYU Langone. Thank you all for being here. I'm excited to be facilitating and learning a lot today, I'm sure myself. I want to just first off say to the audience that at least I'm coming at this conversation as a facilitator, thinking of trans healthcare as all healthcare when you're trans, if you're navigating that. And I think that it would be a good place to start if one of our guests would like to give a brief background on the kind of specific types of healthcare trans people seek out, whether disproportionately because of their own gender identity or just in general, what do trans people seek in health services and why, as we get into this. Anyone can start this discussion if they'd like to. Maybe I'll throw it to Viv, if that's okay.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, that's cool with me. Mm-hmm. So there's obviously like an array of healthcare that we interact with on a regular basis. So over the lifetime, there's like the standard healthcare folks, right? There's a pediatrician for folks that are you or children. And then as you grow up, you might go into like an adult healthcare provider. And then out of that adult healthcare, you might need someone or specialist for your reproductive health and then there's like our specialists, right? So like, we also have diabetes, we also have cardiovascular thing, there's like all of these things, nutritionists, different kinds of folks that we interact with. We interact with folks that are in those kinds of clinical spaces. And then outside of the healthcare system, as we grow up, there's also interactions with like holistic healthcare. If we're like seeking acupuncture or massage therapy or other kinds of group therapy and group peer support also that's offered in the community, right? And then there's also like Reiki services and other holistic care services that we also seek as part of our healthcare throughout our lives. And then as we grow older, there's also geriatric healthcare. We're growing and we're becoming elders now at more and more numbers as time goes by. And that's really what we're fighting for. So then there's also geriatric healthcare, and as our healthcare intersects at those different points, so also going on with specialists that we might interact with more as we get older. And then there's also like, you break a bone, you're going to need an orthopedic surgeon or an orthopedic doctor, you know, you're going to interact with these different services at different points. And then there's mental health care, and there's within mental health care, there's a lot of different resources that we might seek out. And there's a lot of different therapies that are luckily available, and trans folks are really resilient. So there's also different kinds of therapies that we might seek out. You know, there's like animal and equine therapies now that we might find, and music therapy and art therapy, and different kinds of therapies that we can interact with, that now there's a lot of availability for that because there's members of the community that are art therapists or music therapists, you know, and that we can interact with on that level. So there's also creative ways that we look to interact with the healthcare system that we know we have to get into. You know, folks are like, I know I need mental health care, but I don't want to sit in an office and just like vent for an hour. So we get creative with it. And so there is that extra like step out that we might do into these other kinds of therapies. And then there's surgery, right? So like for some folks, surgery or endocrinology, you know, gender-affirming hormones, those are two other specialties that we might go to. And within surgery, there's plastic surgery, and then there's also surgery for our gonads or reproductive system or reconstructive surgeons too, right? So there's different surgeons even within the different kinds of surgical journeys that we might take that we need to interact with. And then the follow-up care after that, we might be following up with other providers also. And then we also live at an intersection where more and more reproductive access and reproductive care is starting to be integrated into different levels of our care as we grow up. So talking to folks about our sexual health and accessing sexual health services and harm reduction services and recovery services, and having access to that kind of care is also part of our life journey for different folks at different times.
Cool. Thank you so much for that very thorough and succinct like background on this. And I think that speaks to the point of, it's like, there are so many ways, you know, trans people experience health issues that cis people do. And I think like breaking down that kind of wall of like not sequestering trans healthcare into like a kind of corner while we're talking about this, is very important to establish in this conversation. I'm wondering, maybe Noah, you'd be interested, like because of your work with insurance barriers and obstacles to accessing trans healthcare. I wonder if you'd be comfortable giving a slight background on some of those like basic barriers that trans people often face before we kind of get into the, well, how do you get around those part of the discussion?
Yeah, I would say there's two. We can talk about the barriers now, and we can also put everything in historical context. And since I focus on insurance coverage, we can take that lens. So historically, insurance has not covered trans-related healthcare, and that has created a cycle of exclusion. That meant that trans people were not talked about in medical school, and surgeons did not get training on how to do trans-specific surgeries. And because of that, because of the lack of insurance coverage, only people who could afford to pay out of pocket were able to access care. So care, while originally actually it was done in academic medical centers like Stanford and Johns Hopkins and the University of Virginia, then through deliberate action by a person with religious opposition got the clinic shut down at Johns Hopkins, which had a ripple effect of shutting down the other clinics as well. And that's when it moved to this private, these private surgeons operating as solo practitioners, and they were not publishing research. They were not sharing information. It was this very enclosed system, and very few people could access care. And then that really, I would put you know, a lot of different factors started to change. And once we started challenging the insurance exclusions and things like Medicare began to cover it, then we actually began to see a resurgence of the academic medical centers. Now there's, you know, maybe 80 or so clinics around the country. And we're seeing a lot more research being published. So, but yet there's still a lot of problems accessing coverage. And I think there's two main barriers at this point. There's blanket exclusion. So that might be where in other states, in some Medicaid programs still have blanket exclusions. New York, thankfully, does not. But you can still be in New York and you could work for a private employer and they might have a blanket exclusion that just says, we don't cover sex reassignment surgery or sex transformations or sex change. That language would be right in the plan document. And so any kind of trans-related care would be excluded. And then even if there's not that blanket exclusion, there's still a lot of different forms of healthcare that are deemed to be cosmetic or not medically necessary by insurance companies. And they have clinical policies for gender dysphoria treatments. Generally, you know, what evidence, what kind of documentation do you need to present to the insurance company for them to cover it? So they generally always cover bottom surgeries, hysterectomies, genital surgeries, and mastectomy. But then breast augmentation, facial surgeries, voice therapy, voice surgery, hair removal, body contouring, those things are much harder to get covered and still have a lot of explicit exclusions.
Right. Yeah. That is, I guess, super good foundation, like foundational knowledge to have, like going into this, I think. I'm wonder if I'm, well, I guess I kind of want to just open up to Jeremy to talk a little bit about, like, you know, trans youth and mental health barriers specifically, as well, as we're kind of creating this foundation, if you have anything to kind of add to this.
Yeah, I think that all of the barriers that Noah and Deb were bringing up, or the systems of care that people interact with, are really the same in children and adolescents, except you have the added layer of some sort of caretaker involved in the process or getting in the way of the process. And I think very often for trans youth, some of the biggest things that we are contending with as mental health providers, who particularly for minors, people who aren't of the age of majority, there is some sort of required participation through one way or another. If you're trying to access, let's say, gender-affirming medical care of any variety, which for children and adolescents can look like menstrual suppression, puberty blocking, it can be gender-affirming hormones. It can also be some surgical interventions, depending on the age. Their participation in treatment with various mental health providers often is really more about whether or not the parents are open enough with what's going on and comfortable enough to even engage in a conversation. So across the lifespan and across early childhood and adolescent and young adulthood development, we see all of these things coming into play, because the insurance question, to Noah's point, or some of the things that are sometimes barriers with insurance, can also add additional caveats based on the person's age or how long they need to have been experiencing their gender identity or been on a hormonal intervention before they can qualify for something else. Or their insurance company will say, you know, from a mental health care standpoint, we'll cover this type of therapy, but not this type of evaluation. And then the type of conversations that may need to be had with a young person about, say, fertility preservation, risks and benefits related to hormones, that's a huge financial burden. And frankly, part of the challenge in the United States is that mental health care is very often siloed and taken out of insurance coverage plans, where you then have a medical intervention where the insurance company says, you know, we need a letter from a mental health provider, we'll cover the medical intervention, but we won't cover your meetings with the mental health care. So it just kind of ends up being this added layer when trans youth are already in a position of having a lot of vulnerabilities. And then the systems of care become really complicated by state, by insurance provider. And then obviously we know politically it's sort of a hot topic in particular.
Absolutely. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you all for, like, laying the groundwork here. I think that we should hop into kind of some basic responses and basic rights around receiving care when you're confronting these barriers, as you know, that's why we're here. But I kind of like, basically, if you're faced with transphobia or like gender discrimination in a clinic or hospital setting, like what are some basic ways or what recourse can one take in that situation, which is very broad, but I'm yeah, just like, how do you immediately respond to like transphobia in a clinic setting? And I think that there's also a lot of like anxiety about seeking out medical care without having a toolkit to respond to that sometimes. I mean, myself as a trans non-binary person has definitely experienced some of that anxiety going into, especially like intake with new providers. Anyone can jump in.
I think one of the things I want to say too is that the issue of discrimination or improper, unethical treatment of trans non-binary people in the medical healthcare setting is not just an issue for trans and non-binary people. It's for, as a cisgender provider and a cisgender person, and for whoever, if there are any cisgender people, meaning your gender identity aligns with the sex you're assigned at birth, it's also your responsibility to bring these things to providers' attention. And some of the first recommendations I make to people, that's more of a covert form of making people feel uncomfortable in healthcare, is when you're filling out intake paperwork, right? If you walk into a doctor's office and they give you the options, male or female, the more people that walk up to that front desk or contact a patient experience navigator, which is sort of a term I can explain a little bit more, and say, hey, have you all taken a look at this paperwork? You know, do you ask questions about how you'd like patients to be referred to on paper? Do you give people other options to write in their gender identity? Little things like that, I think, actually really change the patient experience for members of the community. And it can't only be members of the community asking their doctors for that. So that, maybe that's not quite the answer to your question about what do you do in the moment, in those moments of discrimination. But for me, I think thinking systemically, part of the challenge is that trans or non-binary people walk into a doctor's office and it's not built for them, because there are very few providers who are members of the community. And those who are, understandably, are doing what they can, but it can't only be the trans, non-binary, gender fluid people saying this is what we need. It needs to be a standard of care. And so the more that people can ask and notice those things, even if it's not your lived experience, that's my biggest thing that I recommend to people. So that means if you're an older person, you have a grandparent who maybe is in a nursing home, you go to a doctor or a specialist, looking and asking those questions is a really important part of being a trans-affirming person in our society.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it is important with that question to roll in, you know, the systemic elements of this. This is not confronting transphobia in the medical system is certainly not an individual task. And also I would be happy to hear more, you know, suggestions you might have for people who are like bystanders or, you know, someone accompanying someone who is trans into a medical interaction as well. So I think that's great to bring up and like zoom out too. Viv, do you have anything to add to this question?
Oh, I think Noah was about to say something. Noah,
I was going to actually, but yeah, from a really practical point of view, if you're going to any kind of like hospital or clinic, they're going to have a patient advocate or an ombud person that you can reach out to get assistance. And then some will actually have even more, like more specifically a transgender patient advocate if you're going to like a really big entity or a specialized clinic. And then outside of that, on our website at transhealthproject.org, under the tools section, I do have a list of all the different places you can file discrimination complaints. So that's more, you know, if you're really not getting it resolved, but it, you know, half of the problem is having the courage to, you know, correct people when they're misgendering you and to ask for what you need. So bringing an advocate with you, a friend or family member, not, you know, that's not always that's not really necessarily possible during COVID times, but you know, if you're somebody who actually, you know, does need a support person, you can get a reasonable accommodation and bring another person. But having somebody there as a witness is, you know, if you were experiencing really severe discrimination that you were going to pursue legally later on, that would be helpful. So taking notes, if it becomes apparent that they're not listening to you, getting the names of people who are engaging in the discrimination is helpful, and just, you know, keeping really detailed notes about who was in the room, who said what, and so that you could then go to, say, for example, the New York City Commission on Human Rights or the New York State Division of Human Rights or the New York State Attorney General. These are all agencies that are very interested in pursuing transgender discrimination, specifically in hospital contexts as well. They've all prioritized the issue, and we do have explicit protections in public accommodations in New York for gender identity and transgender status. So nobody is supposed to be misgendering you or using your dead name or housing you inappropriately with, you know, somebody of the wrong gender. So those are all, you know, but nevertheless, people do contact Transgender Legal Defense and Education Fund about the discrimination that they're experiencing. And so that's another resource that you can do. You can immediately call us when you're in the situation, and we can give you some, you know, tips right then. But it's very important to report discrimination, because you might just kind of write it off and think, well, I can handle it, or like, I'll just never go back there. But somebody, another trans person, is going to go there. So if you have the mental bandwidth to report it and to follow up with it, that's going to help the next person make sure it doesn't happen to someone else.
Yeah. Sorry. I just really quick. I just like how that also ties into this kind of larger systemic issue that Jeremy's talking about. This kind of network of accountability is a part of that as well. And I think that's good to know.
Yeah. So that network of accountability and like the people that, like, as you zoom out, being involved, definitely play a part and are a part of that. I'm also a super Taurus queer earth sign that loves self-care. So I also have like a number of like self-care things or like personal things that me as like a queer trans person and is like a brown person from I was from Southern New Mexico. So like being in the borderlands also, navigating the healthcare system. I also like to do a lot of the things that I know will help me soothe me or feel better as I go through the process. So I'm gonna log on to the website of whatever provider I'm going to visit. And if they have their intake forms that I can download there, I will do that and I will fill them out and I will write all the little notes and like write, you know, like, this is not accurate. Like, what are you asking? If you're asking for a gender marker, are you asking for my sex assigned at birth? Are you asking for the gender marker on my insurance card? What do you need from me? Are you asking for my pronouns? Because that might be totally different than what my gender identity is and what you would presume my pronouns to be too, right? So like, if I can download the intake forms, then I take that with me. There's also a number of resources, like community resources, that I've been able to gather at different conferences or like free things, like the Philly Trans Health conference, that like they also have online resources. So even if I can't go to a conference, I go to the website of the conference and I look at all the resources and all the people that are vending at those conferences, because usually they have like community resources that they're going to have at their tables that we can take to different places. So one of those is like a trans card, and it's just like a business card style thing that says like transgender card on it, like on the side, and it just looks like a weird business card. And when folks sign in, like I've used it too, when signing in and I like sign in my name, I just hand it to them. And then they open it and it says, my name on my insurance is this, my gender marker is this, this is what I go by, and I'm here for this care. And so it takes that pressure off of me And that's like something that you can write on your own business card. You know, you can print out your own on a template that you have on your own too, or just write it on a post-it note before you walk in. That's totally fine. And that took the pressure off of me for a very long time while I was doing the work to figure out how I was going to approach them in the moment and when I encountered those visits in person. So I also like do that self-care. And then I also like, just like, so like I always have something that I can fidget with. I always have something that I can, you know, take into any of those situations. So if I am feeling nervous, I'm not feeling like I'm having to bottle it up in the moment. Sometimes that means taking a coloring book to wait with and like color and do stuff there, a crossword puzzle, whatever. And just knowing that I can do something else before then. And then especially if they have to like call my name or anything like that, then I know that I can let them know that information as I'm going in. And then also afterwards, giving myself a high five, giving myself a fun recess, like afterwards or whatever I need to say like, yes, good job, Vib. Like you went and you did that. It was scary. You did your best and it was there. And part of that is like asking people like, yeah, can you come to the doctor with me? And letting them know also like what things I'm comfortable with happening there. Or if I just want them to document the stuff that they like witness and that they hear and be like a second person to how the surgeon is approaching me or how I'm navigating those things so that I don't have to worry about those things and I can just be there and be present. And then afterwards, we can figure out if I want to send an email over to Noah and be like, Noah, this is happening. Come help me, please. You know, or contact the patient experience folks or see who can be there as a resource. But letting folks know of those kinds of boundaries and the kind of support that I need going into those different places. And that's true for like the dentist. And that's true for going to a surgeon, you know, whatever you're doing.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I really appreciate the very practical advice of just like step by step. Here are also some ways to just like take care of yourself and give yourself a little bit of space between you and like the system as you're engaging with it. And I think that's really wonderful. We're talking a lot about when you're already accessing healthcare, kind of ways to cope with or respond to forms of discrimination or fear of discrimination. But I want to make sure that we back up and talk about how do you even access care in the first place, especially low-cost forms of healthcare. And I guess speaking around like transitional health, specifically. What are some good things to know about the current state of medical coverage of hormone therapy or forms of surgical medical transition in New York State? Maybe I'll pass it off to Noah because I know you were talking about this a little bit earlier.
Yeah, so Medicaid is very good in terms of, you know, they cover pretty much everything. And then outside of that, you know, what I left out of what I said earlier, what the problems are, even if you have coverage for trans-related care, you're still stuck in a system of private insurance that we have in this country, which is terrible for everybody. And so you might not even be able to afford your deductible or your, you know, other charges that go along with the surgery, even if it's like officially covered. There might not be qualified surgeons in network, and then they're going to charge you exorbitant rates to go out of network, and you have to try to jump through hoops to get them to consider to be in network. So, you know, having a coverage alone is not sufficient. There's still a lot of barriers to care. That said, there is a special enrollment period for marketplace plans. So if you miss that, you can get a marketplace plan now and they should all cover it in New York. You can look more specifically at the specific clinical policy for that insurance company, which are also listed on the transhealthproject.org website to see if they're going to give you trouble about the specific care that you need. And then if you happen to work for an employer that has a self-funded plan, which is a group health plan that they themselves run, you might need to be talking to HR if there's a barrier that you're running into there, because they might be able to help you get the coverage that you need. And also it would be unlawful for them to have trans exclusions in their employee health plan if they did have such exclusions.
Great. Yeah. When we're, yeah, I want to get like as specific as possible as well, and ask Jeremy, you know, if you are a trans youth looking for transitional healthcare, what does that look like for you specifically in terms of access in New York?
So I think the biggest thing for trans youth, as I said, is that if we're referring to youth as really anyone under the age of 18, there's really a lot of limitations in terms of what you can access that doesn't involve some sort of caretaker. However, the nice thing is that in New York State specifically, there are some options at certain community clinics, like a place like Planned Parenthood in the state of New York and Callen-Lorde, where if you're over the age of 16, there's a lot of information and services that you're entitled to confidentially and privately. And places like Callen-Lorde and Planned Parenthood will also work with, you know, 16, 17 year olds, soon to be 18 year olds, about low cost options, a lot of subsidized programs for, let's say, even things, I know this isn't necessarily healthcare related, but applications for name change forms or things like menstrual suppression, that for, you know, people who may have a female body over the age of 16, you're entitled to those services confidentially at most community health clinics. So really the landscape is very narrow in terms of what trans youth can access without some sort of caretaker involvement, really before the age of 16, before the age of 18, with a few options. If frankly, you live in the New York City area, this is a part of a reason why the majority of my work and the work at NYU that our trans youth health program does is really working on helping to build caretaker and community support, because we can't get people to walk through the door if the vested adults in their lives aren't willing to move forward with even conversations about healthcare. So to be honest, it's a tight landscape and there's few options.
Yeah, and I think, thank you for the Callen-Lorde plug. So yeah, Callen-Lorde is definitely one of those options. Yes. With my patients or different folks that I talk to, I also like to recommend resource centers or getting in touch with local community centers and LGBT centers. They do a lot of clinics and do outreach with a lot of programs that also work with different programs that have like huge grants for providing healthcare to folks in rural areas or in other areas, and can have things. So like at Callen-Lorde, we have what's called a MMU, a mobile medical unit, that we can take out to community events to meet folks there and take providers out to them to provide some services. So similar things like that can happen in different communities. For example, in New Mexico, there's the Transgender Resource Center of New Mexico that works with other physicians and with mental health providers. So you can go on a Wednesday and have a mental health provider visit, and you can go on a Thursday and have a drop-in medical provider visit. And so it's working with organizations that are really harm reduction focused and really have that community focus of bringing the providers to where participants are already at and to where you already feel safe at. So I know in New York City, there's several drop-in centers where folks can go and they can access laundry services and other like daily activity services that connect folks to these different services that are on the spot. They're already covered by grants, so you don't have to worry about the receipt coming back to whatever person or whatever. Some programs have limitations with youth, but they also usually have special programs for youth. And that's sometimes like under 24 or under 18. So really tapping into those community resources to also see what's available there for that level of support. I know that there are a lot of undocumented folks that will go to these kinds of clinics or to these kinds of programs, because they can access care that way once they're able to go and seek their own healthcare. So that's also another overlap that exists for accessing care when you can't necessarily pay for it. And then also like in terms of like accessing hormones or accessing other things, right? Like you might be able to see a general practitioner that'll write you the prescription for hormones, but insurance won't cover the hormones themselves, right? So getting on websites like GoodRx or helprx.info and looking up those coupon codes and those discounts so that you can figure out all stack all of the discounts that you can to make sure that you can continue having access to the medication for the, like, you know, if you're 16 or 17 for the 2 or 3 years before you might have like college insurance that would cover that or other programs. So also interacting with things like if you're a student or if you're in school, the health-based student centers, and they might partner with other community organizations that can also connect you to primary care or reproductive care, like the ones that Jeremy was talking about also. And that stuff is also usually covered by grants and by public funding. So nothing gets back to the folks that you might be scared about finding out about your care or might be a barrier to gaining access to care also.
Awesome. I'm another, I think, group of folks who I'm curious about accessing medical care are trans folks who are considering pregnancy or are already pregnant, and specifically like that form of reproductive health care. And if any of you would have comments on kind of resources in New York that would focus on that specific form of care, which I think is like can be very difficult to navigate walking into any, you know, hospital or doctor's office.
For sure. I'm not a birthing doula, I'm a surgery doula, but there is a lot of overlap in that, like it has a reproductive justice focus and like a bodily autonomy focus that's also there. And so with accessing care, especially with that is looking to community. Again, you know, I'm very community resource oriented. So in Brooklyn and in New York City, there's Ancient Song Doula Services, and there's other like doula services and community pregnancy workshops that work with pregnant people. And like, that's the language that they use. And so it's already a part of the way that they provide care for folks. And like Ancient Doula, like they provide scholarship services or they provide sliding scale services. There's places like Third Root and other community resources that have been there for folks that might be disproportionately also affected by the medical system, right? Like there's a lot of Black and Brown folks that have developed a lot of resources to provide care and information for each other that has been left out throughout the entire medical process, right? Like you can be one of those folks that does have a general practitioner, an endocrinologist, get to go have a hysterectomy or to go and talk about fertility, and no one has talked about the effects of hormones on your fertility or asked you any questions about genetic material. So like there are all of those community resources that are also community minded and might be able to guide you in the general, like, okay, this is what I can tell you about your rights as a pregnant person, right? And these are the things that I know. And so there's an element of that might be like also meeting them with where they're at, right? Like I'm here for pregnancy information from you, and then I'm gonna go and I'm gonna apply that to how I want to have a family, how I want to go through this process, and the expectations that I have for going to the fertility clinic, for assessing for the cost of, you know, freezing my genetic material for a year, right? And what's the cost of that? What's the access to that? And then also in the big picture, there's like the policy that is also changing over time. So there was like recent stuff talking about like more coverage for LGBTQ people to have access to fertility treatments. There's already like a lot of holes in what insurance will cover with fertility treatment in general right now, right? So also advocating like on the big scale when you feel like you're getting to that level and you feel like you have the capacity to advocate for those kinds of things, to also advocate for those resources to be updated. But for a personal person that is looking to get pregnant and to have those kinds of resources, there are resources out there, and there are usually like groups or support groups or special like cohorts that sometimes get together of patients that are navigating these processes. I have, you know, a group of patients that all happen to have found themselves at the same fertility clinic, and they were connected by a support group there, you know? And so they were able to have support amongst each other. And for some people, this becomes a plan as a part of bottom surgery coordination, right? Like as a part of like, I know that that's something that I want, and then having that, or as a part of the decision to not have bottom surgery. And that's the only way that it is getting brought up to them as an option, right? So looking for those options and those resources and where you have sources and community connections to those resources.
Yeah, that's great. And again, like, I don't know, important to kind of keep talking about that community or like community driven care, or like communities taking care of themselves within a system that, you know, we're not individually going to dismantle when we're walking, you know, walking into a space to seek care as a trans person. You know, a reminder to like whoever is watching or whoever who might be seeking this kind of care out, that like, yeah, you can find support groups, and like these are resources that do exist in the city and the state. And that's a whole part of, you know, finding people who are gonna be affirming to you as well, talking to one another.
And that's our generational resilience too, right? Like that's how we've survived. We've been outside, we've had to exist outside of these systems for this long. We've had to, the way that we've been able to survive to this point and to be advocating in these ways is because we had, you know, generations of people that were taking care of each other when they would leave their house and then go change at another person's house and then be able to go live their life and then change back on the way back, you know? Like, that is how we've survived, and that's how we keep each other going and keep each other moving. And it's, that's why it's this like tag team effort. You know, it's like, today I don't have the capacity to write this long email to this patient experience person and do all of this. Part of my resilience is taking a bath when I get home and taking care of me, so that I know that one day when I do have the capacity, I will do it and it'll be okay, right? So relying on those community resources, because it's been such a vital point of our survival and our resilience to this point too.
Yes, absolutely. And I think that that's actually an interesting segue, because I wanted to kind of speak to, you know, trans incarcerated folks as well. And like, which is, you know, this is also a broad community that like, you know, for example, like I do work with the organization Black and Pink. That's like an example of a network of, you know, trans and queer folks supporting each other from the outside and inside and doing that kind of community care and mutual aid. But I think that like, I don't know much about accessing gender affirming healthcare while you're incarcerated or when you're just getting out, or what those networks look like. And I'm wondering if any of you would be able to speak to a little of that, you know, just what is it like trying to access gender-affirming healthcare? What can you do if you're incarcerated or recently released to whether access like patient networks, like you're saying, Vib, or, you know, just really practically navigate the system legally?
Totally. Jeremy or Noah, do you all wanna?
Well, I think honestly, my experience with this has been limited because I work with so many youth, and not to say that youth people can't be formally incarcerated as well, but I think this issue disproportionately affects adults. I think that part of the challenge in general is that healthcare access after you've been incarcerated is hard for all adults. It creates a lot of different vulnerabilities and systems that need to be navigated even further. I don't know too much about it. I'd be interested, Viv or Noah, if you've had experience with this.
Yeah, so my experience with working with folks that are incarcerated or formerly incarcerated also overlaps a lot with the folks that I've worked with, being from Southern New Mexico, that are being released from detention centers or that are in the process of seeking citizenship or asylum and are undocumented and are either at those centers or being released to sponsorship elsewhere. And so as far as access to those things, it's heavily, so while incarcerated and while at any of those locations, there's a couple of different things that like legally might protect someone or allow for some protections as far as like being segregated or like there's a huge history of like folks being sent to like isolated, you know, separation and that being like for their safety as opposed to like them just being safe in where they are or being able to be in places close to them. So PREA is one of the policies that is applied to trans healthcare and trans care basically for folks that are incarcerated, and that's been applied to a lot of care in detention centers and that we've been able to use for folks that we're advocating on behalf of whenever I'm involved in those kinds of cases. Aside from that, the gender affirming care. So when I was working with folks, it was a lot of coordination with the on-site healthcare and with it, it gets really dicey and hard as like a community advocate that like, personally speaking, I'm an abolitionist, right? So like, it's very hard to be interacting with these law systems and these systems that like, I have very core beliefs against, but if I don't train these folks and these correctional officers, this is my trans sibling that is here in this detention center and is interacting with them on a daily basis. So the way that I've navigated it with the organizations that I've worked with this is twofold. So providing the training for the correction officers and the people that are at the facility that they're at to inform them on trans healthcare and on just cultural humility around gender, right? And talking to them about that and letting them know about the disproportionate violence and the incarceration and the homelessness, and then also the criminalization of being trans, right? Like over time, it's been against the law. You know, we were getting tons and tons of citations and thrown into jail over it. So talking to them about that history and providing that context, but then on the other side, also being there and hearing from the folks that are incarcerated and that are at those facilities. So a portion of that has also been like offering them and putting money on their books, right? So that they can get the things from the commissary that help them to do whatever they need to do for themselves. And also advocating for the facility that they're at to engage with healthcare providers or with, again, those organizations that go to different places and to different clinics and stuff like that, that are doing those outreach programs and have programs that go into work at the different facilities and detention centers. So there's a couple of actually like groups of private physicians that also get together and that will go to these different detention centers and to these different areas and vaccinate folks, test them for hepatitis, provide hepatitis treatments, provide STI treatment, you know, provide all of these different things that they wouldn't have access to otherwise. So I would advocate for, you know, if there are organizations like Black and Pink that are doing, you know, that correspondence and stuff, to check in every once in a while and be like, hey, is there any kind of advocacy like that we can get involved in, that we can connect to other orgs about, or maybe like we realistically, right, we're not going to be able to do all of the things that they need because they should just be able to come out. But like we can take bite sizes of these different things and apply those and try to get in touch with these different organizations that have been, you know, there are a ton of huge checks that are handed out on TV all through the month of June. All those big old corporations put rainbows on all kinds of things and say that they are giving all this money. This is where we have the voice and the place to be like, hey, you know, whatever Rainbow Center, you received $50,000 from Coca-Cola. Let's redistribute those funds, you know, or whatever, right? And so applying that stuff to affect and to directly serve those folks that are looking for those services. And then as soon as folks come out, then they have access, you know, depending on the different places, folks come to Callen-Lorde. A lot of the times when they're released from places in New Jersey or in other areas, we absolutely serve folks. As a human, you have a right to healthcare, So whether you can pay for it or not, you know, things might get dicey after that. But like, if you're a human and you're bleeding on the side of the street, somebody's got to take care of you no matter what, right? And that can come to fruition in a whole lot of ways. It doesn't just have to be that you're bleeding out on the side of the street.
Thank you. Yeah. And I know that it's like a very, all of these questions are difficult to answer, and a lot hinge on this, like, I don't know. Like, we keep going back to like, well, hopefully there are places, you know, like Black and Pink that can do this advocacy work, because there are no great answers to a lot of these questions. But I also appreciate how you all have provided a lot of like practical information, and also like represent organizations where people can reach out to actively to do that. And also, anyone watching, I put the Trans Health Project link in the chat, but I will continue to put things in there for people to access as we go along. I want to talk a little bit more about mental health care resources, recommendations about taking paths for trans people to take to find gender-affirming mental health care at a low cost. I think that I personally know a lot of trans people who are like, for example, like, I desperately need therapy, but this just seems too complicated. Like, this just seems too much to bite off to even start the process, and then often like push that off, or feel like there are just very few queer people who are practicing like certain forms of therapy, and don't know where to begin to look for them. So I don't know, Jeremy, if you'd like to comment on that a little bit.
Yeah, I certainly can. And if anyone has read anything about mental health in our country in the past year, we know that things are in high demand, let's say. And I think that that is creating a lot of problems in New York City, which is a particularly unique mental health care system, in that there are, in my opinion, one too many providers in private practice pushing people to need to use out-of-network benefits if they have them. And I think that my recommendations in terms of this are, one, that in the context of COVID, demand is really high, which means I'm currently struggling right now to find referrals for anyone. Wait lists are just really long. And that's, I think, the first thing, really just more to validate if anyone's listening to this who's like, I can't find someone who's available. It's not you. You're not doing anything wrong. The mental health care system is strapped right now. The other things I would recommend are that there are a lot of different places within New York City that will give options specifically, or are starting to move towards a model for sliding scales that are based on identity status. It's kind of a complicated field right now, because it's meaning a lot of healthcare systems are picking and choosing whose identity is sort of worthy of a lower fee and whose isn't, which is a complicated issue. But I think a few recommendations I would make more practically if people are having a hard time finding a therapist, or who maybe, if you go on, let's say, Psychology Today, which is a great resource where there are hundreds, meant thousands of therapists in the area that you can look through, is asking a few specific questions when you do actually get to speak to providers, like asking people who may say they have expertise in gender, how many trans or non-binary people have you worked with before? How old were those people? What did you work with them through? Those are appropriate questions. You don't need to ask for details or identifying information about those people, but in order to feel confident that you're making a decision about a provider, because there are very few trans providers who can work from a lived experience standpoint. So plenty of people like me who are cisgender, who work in the mental health field, who developed this specialty, but ultimately it's not my experience. So you want to be asking that those people, you know, have you had training in working with this community? How often and how long have you been working? Because you can have someone who's worked in the field for 20 years and had one patient who came out to them as queer, and they're saying they have gender experience, which is not the same thing. The other thing I would recommend for people is that the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, which is a very large organization albeit maybe a bit of a controversial organization, has a lot of different resources out there. And they do have a list that they put online of people who participated in some of their trainings. That includes people on the mental health side of things, but it also includes medical providers, everyone from dermatologists to physical therapists to dentists. And their website does have a drop-down menu you can search by location. And those are maybe just a smaller group of people who you can know for sure have at least participated in some sort of formalized training. Because I think the access and to care issue is one issue in paying for it. The other issue is actually having specialized, unique, sensitive, responsive, compassionate care for a member of this community is particularly hard to come by.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you. Also, there are so many great resources that you all are sharing, and also want people to know that they can rewatch this video at any time and pick up some of these names and stuff and you know, review this whenever. It'll be up on our channel. I think that's all really great information, especially noting that, you know, noting somewhat the obvious, but we are in a pandemic. Our healthcare system is strapped. It already was. And I'm wondering, Noah, if you would be able to extrapolate a little bit on any kind of, I don't know, legal updates of like what's been going on healthcare wise, like around trans folks in the past few years, or if there are any updates regarding the pandemic that would be relevant to people who are seeking, I don't know, care right now. Cause yeah, like it was good to be reminded. It's like, there are wait lists for mental health care right now. Like people are not, I don't know, there's, or talking about being able to bring like an advocate into a clinic or not. I feel like these are things that folks would like to know.
Yeah, I think the really exciting thing is the change in administration. And, you know, on day one, President Biden signed two executive orders, one specifically around LGBT issues and the other more broadly about equity. And so, you know, we've already seen HUD come out and say they are accepting discrimination complaints based on LGBT status, and, you know, HHS should be doing so as well. So, you know, it previously, you know, I would have said that any discrimination against trans people in healthcare is unlawful. Any denial of insurance coverage for trans healthcare is unlawful. But now, once again, we have the backing of the federal government to enforce the laws that are already on the books. And so it should be a relief that we no longer have a federal government that is chipping away at trans health protections, but is instead, once again, enforcing the law and trying to ensure that everyone has access to healthcare. So on the COVID front, I know, you know, people were waiting lists were already very long for trans-related care, going back to the lack of qualified providers caused by the historical discrimination against trans people. So now with surgeries being rescheduled, those wait lists are even longer. So I certainly understand people's frustration. And I think it's important to recognize that the trans surgeries weren't targeted for being postponed. It was all non-emergency surgeries. So that doesn't make it any easier, but you know, hopefully we're on the right track now with the, you know, new administration taking things seriously in terms of distributing the vaccine and everything else. So hopefully people can get the care that they need sooner rather than later.
Yeah, I was very about the status of, you know, elective surgeries or whatever of being rescheduled during COVID. So I appreciate the update on that. I think so. We're hitting around five. I don't see any questions in the Q&A. So I will ask a question that I'm personally interested in, which is, you know, how do you fight against some of these barriers that we've been talking about, whether it's like insurance or I don't know, any material barriers that trans people experience navigating the healthcare system. That's a broad thing, but, you know, for people who are allies or looking to kind of like join the fight against discriminatory healthcare, where some campaigns that people could look for or actions people could take, where do people start with that?
I think it starts with asking providers you're already familiar with what they're doing for the trans community, right? Like, you are entitled to, you know, if you're in many ways, right, the downside of our healthcare system is it works like a business, but the upside is that also makes, you know, every American a customer. And customers, right, get to hold people accountable and talk to their providers about what's working for them and what isn't. So I think for those of us who are trying to be allies, it means every time you go to a doctor's office, or you're interested in a doctor's office, to Viv's point, like, what can you access and point out that is going to bring to their attention the fact that these people exist? And I think in terms of overcoming some of the mental health barriers, it is a lot of not being afraid, I think, to ask other people outside of your mental health system to write letters of appeal or letters of support to insurance companies. I think very often insurance companies might say something like, okay, we'll provide coverage for X number of sessions because your therapist is recommending it. But if you add in a letter from a pediatrician or a PCP or a counselor from school, sometimes that can actually sway things. So I think in general, eliciting the community support and the vested interest of the people around you, if you have that type of support or trying to find it, is a great way of trying to add pressure to an insurance company, because there can be exceptions made to rules within insurance. Insurance companies obviously don't enjoy that people do that. And the more people that ask, the better.
Yeah. And I think another component is also like, yes, our existence is our resistance, right? So like, that is us taking care of ourselves, and us like keeping on with doing whatever we need to take care of ourselves is vital to the healthcare and the health of all of the other trans people around us, right? So in terms of like Jeremy was saying, getting creative about the mental health care that we're engaging with and the kinds of therapies that we're engaging with, right? Like, some people would argue that being on a team is the best type of group therapy that you can possibly be in, right? And so like figuring out the types of therapies that work great for you. During the pandemic, yeah, there's like a lot of providers that like are having a lot of limitations, and there's a lot of really long wait lists. But there's also been a lot of sprouts of like short-term mental health care or cyber mental health care, telehealth care, that has been able to like provide short-term services or one-time services to folks. And if that means you call a hotline to just vent, if you just need to vent, then call the hotline every other day or every day whenever you need to, you know, like that's what it's there for. And that's why they're constantly receiving that funding, so that that can be accessible. So tapping into either the hotlines or apps, right, like the Calm app or Headspace, or practicing any of those kinds of things. There's a lot of also community resources as far as like group yoga, cutiepoc yoga, Zoom yoga classes, and mindfulness classes and fitness classes that are happening via Instagram and online. So tapping into those and those kinds of groups can also provide, you know, it's not going to provide the one-on-one mental health care, but it's mental health care still. You're still taking care of things, and you're still, you know, letting things out. And there's also groups that also come out of those. So like Headspace now has groups that you can attend, real life groups, and the same with like recalls. And so looking into those other things that have already, that already have that infrastructure to be virtual, you know, like groups on Twitch, groups, if you're in school, if you're enrolled in universities, again, tapping into the resources that you fall in there. One of the resources that I was able to develop was getting in touch with, there weren't therapists that were offered at the school-based health center that I had access to, that like were trans competent or like queer competent at all. So I went to the College of Counseling and Psychology, and I went and I knocked on the doors of a couple of professors that were about to have some graduate students and that were already working on providing care for LGBTQ folks. And so we just worked with them to find somebody that wanted a project to be facilitating LGBT folks or trans folks at that point that were students on campus. And so out of that, we were able to have a support group and then have a whole group of therapy students that had direct supervision and that had folks that were actual, you know, licensed therapists in the next room, but we had access to free therapy on campus through those providers that way. And so it was is a very in touch process of us being able to develop. So get in touch with those resources, get in touch with the on-campus resources to tap into those resources to build that access for you too.
Noah, do you have anything to add to this question in particular? We did actually get some other Q&A questions as well. So
yeah, I would just quickly say, you know, just to give an example, you know, it was an ally who made sure that Planned Parenthood was going to start providing hormones. And then I actually trained them several years ago to make sure they were trans competent. And then I just went there recently and it was really amazing. And so, you know, one person really taking the lead can just create change for everybody.
Absolutely. And that's a great reminder. For the sake of time, I'm gonna check out the rest of the Q&A questions, which I just got sent, which is awesome. Are patients / clients who don't speak English entitled to language or translation support in clinics? And if so, how can they access that? Anyone can hop in on that?
I mean, the answer universally is yes. How people access it, I would imagine, varies by healthcare system. Sometimes the initial paperwork will have a question that will ask you, you know, preferred language. Sometimes that paperwork is in English, so that's not super helpful, which is where the recommendation would also be if you have members of your family or friends or community who can call and ask on your behalf, who may be better at communicating with whoever it is on the other end of the phone, but people are entitled to having that.
Great. Okay, here. Can Viv talk more about what surgery doula work specifically entails?
Sure. That's a popular question. So the surgery doula work that I do is, number one, not medical. So I'm not medically focused. I'm not there to make medical decisions or give medical guidance. What I do is I basically like pass on trans knowledge, if you will, of like community. I do like crowdsourcing of like community organizations and things that can help meet our needs that don't exist within this cis-normative, heteronormative medical system, right? So I do research for transportation resources if transportation isn't being covered or part of the patient's insurance plan on the way to surgery. I also do like home visits before as a part of preparing for surgery. And it's also a component of emotional support. So just talking through. A lot of times we get information dumps at consultations that are like 20 minutes or 3 hours, right? You're in the waiting room for all of the time and you're waiting, and then you're in the patient room and they take your blood pressure and all of these things. And then like in some you're like half naked or fully naked. And then they like give you all of this information of like, okay, this is what I'm gonna do to your body. And transphobia also exists in avoiding conversations about specific trans things with trans people, right? So like someone can be like, yes, yes, do all of the things. But if they're not checking your cholesterol before you have surgery to make sure that it's safe for you to have surgery, that's transphobic too. If, you know, if they're not making sure that you're safe and ticking all the boxes that they would tick off for a cis person naturally in as they're providing care, that's transphobic. And the same is the case for like people that are providing support letters that won't see a patient that needs mental health support after surgery. That's part of the deal that you make with someone that you're providing a letter for, is like, yo, if things go down after surgery and you are having that post-operative depression that like hardly anybody tells anybody about either, you can call me and I'm going to be here and I'm going to see you, right? And I'm invested in your care. And so there's an element of that that like also needs to be understood, because part of that, with the letter needed or not, the understanding that we are targeted in so many different ways. And so like, if you know about like microaggressions and the way that things build up over our care, as we interact in different places, this comes into care. So me as the doula, I come in and I'm like, a lot of validating, a lot of like, yep, that was transphobic. Yep, that's not supposed to be there. Yes, it's crappy that there's an M and an F and there's not anything else. Like, yes. And so doing all of those things. And part of it is sometimes being the patient advocate, sometimes navigating conversations with people at home and being like, hey, you thought this person was having weight loss surgery. Actually, we're talking more gender affirming surgery. This is going to be body contouring, or talking, you know, encourage connecting folks that are partners or that are going to be caregivers for folks after surgery to resources to support them, and also planning for what to expect after surgery, right? So making sure that your caretaker doesn't get burned out, making sure that the boundaries for the caretaking are clear and that you've been able to think through those things. So a lot of it is going through those details and then being at surgery. There's a lot of trauma that can happen, a lot of medical trauma that can lead up to the surgery, and a lot of medical trauma that might come out of surgery. You know, down to the language that surgeons use in our consultations and in different things, you know, calling our bodies different things that we don't call our bodies, calling our parts, saying that gendering our parts, right? And our parts don't have genders. Our parts are ours, right? So I don't have this other body that has all these other needs, or I don't want to totally get rid of all of this, you know, in a nasty way. I want to affirm my gender. So it needs to be safe and affirming. And so as a doula in those processes, those are the things that I'm doing. I'm asking them, you know, what terms do you want the doctors to use? And then when we go into the visits, I say, hey, I'm so-and-so, I use the he pronouns. This is so-and-so, they use these pronouns. This is the anatomy guide. I have anatomy guides for some patients for us to write down the words that they like to use, and we can hand them over to the surgeons or whomever. And then they know the words to use there in the visit that are affirming for the patient. And then after surgery, I do home visits. So I help with also like making before surgery, right? Making sure that everything is accessible and like meal prepping, and also creative ideas. So I've had patients that are like, my boyfriend is going to take care of me. It's going to be great. I'm really scared about his cooking though, because Vib, he cannot cook. And I'm like, okay, so this is what you're going to do. You're going to meal prep for the 1 week that you are meal prepping, and you're going to make an extra serving of the seasoning that you use in all of your proteins. And then he's going to have the chicken bag and the fish bag and the, you know, whatever bag to put on the seasoning on whatever food you have, so that you know it's going to taste the way that you they know that they're going to have good food. And so they're going to be hungry and wanting to take care of themselves. So after surgery, I do that. And then for the more complicated procedures, I walk them through like explaining the giant box of wound care and gauze and all of the things that you get sent home with after surgery. And then that's it. And then I, you know, I'm around, but you don't need me anymore.
Cool. I appreciate the rundown. That's really cool work. And I did not know that surgery doulas, honestly, were, I've heard of, you know, like grief and death doulas and doulas around pregnancy. And so this is a cool other sector of that work. Okay, let's see. Which organizations or mutual aid groups do you think are doing good work related to this conversation that viewers could get involved in and support? Noah, would you want to start that question off, if you have any in mind?
I don't know. I mean, certainly TILDEF, you know, I could use more help. You know, would love to hire more people and you know, we're really focused on expanding access to trans-related care. But I will defer to others who probably have better organizations.
One that comes to mind is the Trans Housing Coalition. I'm not sure if people are specifically familiar. It's actually, I think, based in Atlanta, but it's a campaign specifically working towards permanent housing and other resources for trans people and particularly Black trans women. That's one that I've just been seeing a lot of recently, and I think it's grown pretty rapidly. There's another one that, give me a second, I'm going to Google. I don't want to say the name incorrectly. Hold on.
So while Jeremy's looking that up, I'm going to name, there's, I could give you a ton, but I'm just going to name a few off the top of my head that I can think of. Black Trans Travel Fund, Black Trans Travel. They do great work, also have a lot going on, need support. The Trans Latinx Coalition. And so there is those folks. There's also Trans Latina Org. They work specifically with undocumented trans folks that are being released and from detention centers, or that are looking for sponsors and that are coming into the United States. ELA, a trans Latinx organization outside of from California, is also another organization. The Transgender Resource Center of New Mexico, that's where I started, so I will always plug them. They work with a lot of undocumented folks. They provide a lot of TG 101 trainings, and they also have a community fund and trans youth programs that are available to folks remotely. So they can provide cash assistance also to folks that need cash assistance. And then there's a ton of organization, you know, GLITS got a bunch of funding and support recently, and there's a ton of Black trans organizations. Decolonizing fitness for nutritional and fitness things, absolutely, and resources too.
The one I was going to say is called the Trans Justice Funding Project, and they provide a variety of different grants and stipends and funds for a number of different causes. They can also provide it to individuals, but in general, it's all things LGBTQ plus focused. That's the one I was thinking about that's been doing a lot of work, particularly in the context of anti-racism.
Awesome. I'm just going to plug one place for mutual aid funds, which is related to incarcerated people having medical access, but Emergency Release Fund is great. And they often, or if you follow them, if they are like exceed their like donation levels, they'll often like recommend other like bail funds and stuff. That's always a great place to support folks, because trans people are criminalized and trans incarcerated people have extremely limited access to medical health care in general, but, you know, specific medical health care, let alone gender-affirming medical care. So, yeah, thank you for all those recommendations, everyone. Let's see. Got a couple more questions. Do you guys have any reading recommendations for anyone on this topic or adjacent?
Trans bodies, trans selves.
Yes.
Trans bodies, trans selves. I had a course that I was lucky enough to have that just so happened to pop up as like a grad student just figuring things out, that was trans and wanted to read the book. And so they made up a class to read the book cover to cover, and six of us joined, and so we did it. And it explains so many different things. There's another version that's coming out, and it's written by trans people for trans people, and in relation to healthcare into all of the variances. Like there's like letters from people and personal pictures and stuff like that. And a lot of libraries and LGBTQ centers have it also, and they offer copies to centers. So if you're somewhere and they have like a queer library and they need a copy, then absolutely that one in terms of healthcare access.
I would also recommend a lot of the books that I recommend tend to be, I think more focused on like educating parents or how to talk to kids about gender. A few that I normally recommend are a book by Jodi Patterson called The Bold World, a memoir of family and transformation that talks about her experience raising one of her trans children. The other books I often recommend are The Transgender Child, which is a book that's a bit more conceptual or theoretical about talking to parents about gender. And then I have a whole list of other things that Madeline, I could maybe send you to if you want to distribute to whoever's interested, that are specifically a list of books for kids, a variety of ages, just talking about the diversity of gender and race and capability and all those things.
Yeah, that'd be great. We can always like pop that in the comments or the chat in the later for people to come back and check out. Appreciate that.
Sure.
I would also use this opportunity to plug. So Blue Stockings Bookstore is a bookstore in New York City from the Lower East Side. It's a queer owned bookstore, and it's also like a community center. There's a group there called Off the Binary that gets together for folks. It's a peer support group. But out of that group and out of the folks at that bookstore, there's also a reading list for trans and non-binary folks and trans and a lot of books that are there and available through that bookstore. And you can order stuff online. So they have a ton of stuff. And they also have zines and stuff that people send in from like local artists that you can also order.
Awesome. Noah, do you have any recommendations? No, okay. That is totally cool. We have one last question, which is, what is the map on Bibb's wall behind you?
That is the bike map for New York City. So I moved here about 2 years ago, and cycling is how I get around. So that is my bike map that I try to kind of sort of memorize, or at least get an idea around of the areas, because I do so many field visits. So yeah, New York City bike map.
Cool. I love that. Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you all so much for being here and providing so much excellent information. I'm definitely going to go back and watch this myself again and write a bunch of stuff down because this is super helpful. Do any of you have any kind of, I don't know, final comments or words or info you'd like to share around trans healthcare before we sign off today?
Just glad people are talking about it.
Absolutely. cool.
Yeah. Well, just happy people are taking, you know, listening and watching and trying to take care and do what you can to take care of you, number one.
Totally. Yeah, well, thanks everybody. And thanks everyone for watching. Again, this is one of several Know Your Rights workshops that we've held over the past few months during the pandemic. We also have many panel discussions that we've been, Justice Initiatives has hosted since the start of the pandemic, when we all went virtual on a lot of different topics. Recently, we've been talking about housing a lot recently. And also we did a panel about documenting the protests of 2020. So like you can find any of it on our channel. Those are just some of the things that we've done most recently. And stay tuned this spring for more. We will be here. So thanks again for you three for coming.